Hare Krishna. Now, language, is this to be translated or English medium? If some of the guests, they may not speak English, I don't know. Pardon? English is fine, okay. On your word, we'll try to speak in English. Can you hear me?
Rivo!
Mostly that came from here. Somebody at the back, can you hear? Yes? Okay. You're welcome to stay. We're happy to be with you. Thank you for coming. Some of you are coming here for the first time tonight. Anybody first time? Hands up. Several of you, but you have tilak already. You've been to a Hare Krishna temple somewhere? Where? Where?
Noida.
Noida. You're from Delhi. Well, thank you for coming all this way, just for tonight's class. Just for the class tonight. Come all the way from Delhi. I'm sure you have other business. But. And some of you are coming fairly recently, I believe. So. We're going to read from the Bhagavad Gita, familiar to everybody, I think, in the room today, maybe one or two exceptions. And we're reading from the second chapter. I think, or I believe, the verses which we'll be chanting is on the board, is that correct? No? No, no problem. But we'll be reading from the second chapter, if you have some access to whatever, online access if you want to follow us. Otherwise, we welcome you to stay and try to listen. Om Gyan Timuram Dasya Ganandana Shalaki Chakshuram Vivilakam. Shri Chaitanya Mahavishnu Kapitani Nabutani Shayam Yoga Gadaam Kudachishwa Nama Om Vishnu Padaya Krishna Krishnaya Vokale Shri Mate Bhakti Vedanta Swami Namaste Sarasvati Devi Gauravani Prasadini Nirvishesha Shunyavadi Paschatvade Shatavi Panchakarma Rudrasya Kripa Sindhu Revasya Patitanam Pavane Vaishnavi Jaya Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhara Shri Vasudeva Gaura Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Vasikaraman, are you facilitating the class? Sort of. What do I do? You just read it through once? But then nobody knows the verse. The 95% of the devotees here probably don't know it. As we like, okay. There's no hard and fast rules. I believe it's text 40. This is quite a famous verse. Second chapter of Bhagavad Gita is basically a summary or an overview of the contents. It's not spoken exactly like that, of course. But in this chapter we see Krishna covering the whole topic of the Bhagavad Gita, more or less, to Arjuna. And predominantly the rest of the Gita is an expansion, since condensed, you could say, aspect, a condensed presentation of the Gita was a little incomprehensible to Arjuna, a little difficult for him to grasp. So what to speak of us? Many people think they know the Gita. One who says, I know the Gita, definitely doesn't know the Gita. It is unlimited. And we need the help of one who is connected, genuinely connected, to the unlimited personality who speaks the Bhagavad Gita. Yes, it's spoken by a personality. It's not just a philosophy which came into existence on its own accord. It is actually the Word of God, the Word of the Supreme Being, who is speaking to us. He's not just speaking to himself. He's speaking the philosophy which is relevant to us in this world to help us to progress towards the spiritual realm, to realize who we are, why this world is here, what is time, what is karma, who is that Supreme Person, and many other topics are discussed between Krishna and Arjuna. But these discussions took place for our benefit, everyone's benefit, whoever hears it as it is. Many times people, realizing the greatness of Bhagavad Gita, in one sense, not in its true form, but in some form, take it upon themselves to write their own commentary, according to their own perception. That is not the Bhagavad Gita. That is someone else's Gita. But not Bhagavad Gita. Bhagavad Gita means the song of God. Not the song of so-and-so. So we have to hear from somebody who knows that song. Who is singing that song and not changing. Otherwise it will be very difficult. Even in the fourth chapter of the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna explains Padvidi Paripatena Paripashnena Sevaya. If you want to know this truth, Arjuna, You have to approach a spiritual master. You have to inquire submissively. Not just inquire. We may inquire, but our inquiry may be challenging or very doubtful. That may be there in the beginning. That's not unexpected. But to really understand this truth of the Gita, this knowledge is revealed from within by Krishna himself. We hear his words, we apply those words in our life, as Krishna explains in the fourth chapter. One who applies himself to this knowledge realizes this knowledge in due course of time. It's like the sun rising, Krishna's Surya Sun. Krishna is like the sun. When we hear his words, they resonate on our consciousness. And if we hear submissively, they change our perception. They change how we see things. We start to realize there's more to life than meets the eye. It's so important to hear in the proper way. Arjuna, in the beginning, you may know, was a little bit challenging. So we're here at the beginning stages, more or less. Arjuna has more or less decided, I will not fight. Okay. That doesn't sound like a very spiritual thought or spiritual subject matter. It's not so much the fight, it's more his attitude. He does not want to perform his duty. And the reasons why he doesn't. Not even he doesn't want to perform his duty, but the reasons why he doesn't want to do it. He's presenting all kinds of good material reasons why he feels he should not fight. In other words, whatever we're doing in life, of course that may not be so dutiful, it may be materially not so friendly, not so favorable, so to speak, but whatever it is, the attitude is the key here. Arjuna's attitude was materialistic, full of material compassion. You can say there's nothing wrong with that, materially speaking. It's heralded as a very good, argument on Arjuna's case. Many arguments, many of them from scripture also. But the purpose of Bhagavad Gita is not just another book. It's not just another book on, let's say, the dharma of this world, how to live well in this world, how to be a good person, how to gain punya, how to go to heaven, how to even get liberated. That's not the purpose of Krishna speaking to Arjuna. This is the bridge, you can say. This teaching is the bridge between material life and spiritual life. It's the instructions to cross that bridge. Some of you may or may not accept or believe or have even heard of a world beyond this one, the spiritual realm. But that's what Krishna talks about on occasion, also in Bhagavad Gita, but primarily the method to reach that spiritual abode, that eternal abode, which is, as the example is given, it's just like last night we were discussing the 15th chapter of the verse describing how this material world is just like a banyan tree. Very complicated. You can't make it out up or down. The Vedas seem to recommend pious activity, various to elevation to the heavens and so on. Very confusing. That's not what Bhagavad Gita is aimed at exactly. It's to free us from that tree of material existence, not to make us comfortable within it. Most of us are looking for comforts. Nowadays in the Western world they have a very common saying, my comfort zone. I don't know if that's infiltrated the vocabulary of India or not. It's very common. Don't disturb my comfort zone. There's no such thing as a comfort zone in this world. Doesn't exist. Nowhere in this word is described by Krishna as dukalyam ashashvatam. Dukalyam, a place of dukkha. My pronunciation is awful, but it probably, maybe you grasp what it means. It means like that, awful, practically. Miserable. A place of suffering. Ashashvatam, temporary. Even if you do get what you're aspiring for a few moments, it's gone. Time takes it away. Why? All this is described in Bhagavad Gita. And when Arjuna refused to fight, he threw down his Gandiva bow, completely bewildered, perplexed, disturbed. But he did one thing. Karpanya dosho pantasvabhava, which chamitam dharmasu mudicheta. He surrendered to Krishna. Please tell me, I'm confused, I'm bewildered. Help me. What am I going to do? I decided not to fight, but I still feel totally disturbed. What am I to do? And that attitude, Krishna began to speak to Arjuna, the knowledge of Bhagavad Gita. The knowledge which we all need to hear if we want to be truly happy, if we want to bring true auspiciousness to our lives and that of others. So Krishna starts basic knowledge, very basic, in his second chapter. He starts with merely Jnana Yoga. Jnana Yoga, just describing the difference between matter and spirit. And specifically, honing in on the direct subject matter of you are not this body. Without this is A, B, C. At least without the theoretical understanding, I am not this body. Spiritual knowledge will never, ever, you could say, be realized. We cannot understand. We will not be able to understand. It's based at least on this principle. Just like in science, they have their, what they call premises, their theories which start with some kind of assumption of some kind, and then they work their theory based upon it. This is not an assumption as such. This is a factual statement. But even if you do, the rest of the Bhagavad Gita can only be understood in that light. That we're not this body. Bhagavad Gita is aimed to help us to realize our spiritual identity. Beyond even just that, what is our eternal constitution? So he starts with Jnana Yoga, you're not the body, explaining it from different angles. Then he describes, you could say, Karma Yoga, the effect of performing or not performing your prescribed duty. Prescribed duty is not just something we like doing. Jai Radha Gopinath, Jai Nakti, Shri Nakti, Jai Gonitai. They're going now, the devotees, the curtain, the gates are closing, and if you don't know it, some devotees will be coming now to dress their lordships for the night. They're dressed in the morning and at night, every day of the week. Yes, Krishna consciousness is not idol worship. This is developing a personal relationship with the Supreme Personality of Godhead. But in order to understand that, we have to have this knowledge of our relationship. It's called sambandhagyan. So now Krishna's going to start talking about a little bit about sambandhagyan, about our relationship, about our spiritual nature. And in this particular verse, it's really only the beginning, and he's describing the path. He's already described two paths, Jnana Yoga and Karma Yoga, which means knowledge in relationship to him also. You could say it's just Jnana and Karma in one sense, because it doesn't directly infer relationship. Yoga means relationship. It's not just an activity. It's not really yoga unless it's related to the Supreme. Otherwise it's just a physical exercise or a mental exercise. It has to be connected to the Supreme. So Krishna teaches us how to connect our karma, our jnana, our everything with him, and it becomes yoga. Why is that? Connection. The word yoga in English means yoke, to connect. It has a similar meaning, to connect with the Supreme Yogeshwar, controller, master of yoga. So this verse today is a very interesting verse. I'll read it with no further ado. Neha vikramo nashosti pachyavayo nagadhyate shvapam apyasya dharmasya trayate mahato vayat. And I'll go straight into the translation. There's a word for word. It's written in the Sanskrit, then in the English transliteration of that Sanskrit, then there's a word for word translation in this version into English, have it into Hindi, Marathi, whatever language you speak, or Gujarati, whatever it may be. And here we have English, so we'll read the English translation. In this endeavor, this is the endeavor of yoga. What he's talking about here is the process of real yoga, the endeavor to connect through one's work or through one's knowledge with him, and ultimately coming, not yet, but coming to bhakti later in this chapter. In this endeavor, there is no loss or diminution. In the material world, everything we do has a beginning and an end. Your karma has a beginning and an end. But on the path of anything connected directly to Krishna, authorized, what is directed in the Vedic literature, given by the pure devotees, that activity or that lifestyle, there is no loss of any kind. It's just like you have in the bank, you put some money in your bank account. You hope it's still there. And you keep adding to it. It hopefully doesn't go away. This is a transcendental bank account. Every single little bit of devotional service adds up. Every little bit of genuinely following the instructions of the Lord, they may in the beginning be more in the mood of, let's say, piety. It may gradually elevate one to the opportunity to begin devotional service to the Lord, direct service. We call it Gyata Sukriti Punya. And then there's Bhakti, devotional activity which leads to Bhakti. When we meet a pure devotee of the Lord and some another, we hear from them or we render some service, and that will slowly build up in our spiritual bank account, and eventually there'll be interest. We'll start to draw interest, and we'll actually want to associate more. We'll want to engage in devotional service, and then our path back to Godhead really takes off. So let's see what Krishna says. In this endeavor, there is no loss or diminution, and a little advancement on this path can protect one from the most dangerous type of fear. We'll hear from Prabhupada what this means. We'll read the purport. Srila Prabhupada, our spiritual master, has written elucidating on these topics, purports, so we can understand how this applies more to ourselves. We're not on the level of consciousness of Arjuna. Very elevated, superly intelligent personality. We could grasp the subject very quickly. We tend to be a little bit slower, plus the fact we are in a different age, a different era, surrounded by all kinds of distractions, all kinds of alternatives of various kinds. Prabhupada writes, activity in Krishna consciousness or acting for the benefit of Krishna. What does that mean, the benefit of Krishna? Why does Krishna need anything from us? He's got everything, he's Atmarama. He doesn't need us. Benefit of Krishna, what it means is favorably, to bring pleasure to Krishna. He doesn't even need it in one sense. We need it. But nonetheless, we want more pleasure for Krishna. Bring him more pleasure. activity which pleases you. And in practical terms, it means acting according to his guidelines. The Vedic literatures come from him. Later on in the Gita, the 15th chapter, this is also explained. Vedasya Sarvajraham Eva Vedya. The Vedas come from him. They're not man-made. They originate from the Supreme Person. They are like guidelines in the material world. Just like if you buy a new item from electronic gadget, the latest Apple Mac or something or another, here's a manual, that goes along with it to give us some idea how to use it. You don't just get it, spend years trying to work out what to do with it. You follow the manual, then you quickly learn how to use that machine. So the Vedas are like a manual, how to live in this world properly. Mostly they aim at the heavenly planets, Tarunyamishra Veda. They mostly deal with the three modes of nature in this world, which lead one to the heavenly planets. But that's the preliminary aspect of the Vedas. Ultimately they're meant for self-realization or God-realization. So step by step, just like in ordinary education, you teach a primary school child very simply. And when he's learned those simple lessons, then you increase the learning. The Vedas give very preliminary knowledge of how we can, you know, progress beyond just uncivilized human life to civilized human life, and then maybe even to the heavens and so on. Bhagavad Gita goes a little further to take us the teachings of the Gita and other scriptures and the Puranas also, take us much further to understand beyond that. Let's see what Prabhupada goes on to say. Acting for the benefit of Krishna, not just for our own benefit, but for the pleasure, as I said, let's put it a different way, not just for our own pleasure, but for the pleasure of Krishna. This is real selflessness. When we talk about selflessness, we sometimes think of nothingness. It's not like that. The materialist person thinks it means acting for the material welfare of others. But that's still not really selflessness, because it's based upon a false presumption or a false understanding, a concept that we're this material body, and that the idea is to try to make this material body a comfort zone. It's false. It's a falsity. It's a dream. It's not really a highly beneficial activity, although it may appear to you. It may help us materially. But spiritually, this is the real, say, essential, important topic here, acting in Krishna consciousness. For the benefit of Krishna without expectation of sense gratification. In other words, without expecting anything in return, not even material piety, not even good karma, not even liberation. Krishna consciousness is so transcendental. Just working for Krishna, that's it. And of course with faith we know that is the highest purpose of a living entity, and such activity will completely satisfy the self without even asking. That's real selflessness. It's the highest transcendental quality of work. Even a small beginning of such activity finds no impediment. Why? Because Krishna helps you on two ways. He helps by taking away obstacles. We may not see it like that. We think he's taking away sometimes what we want or what we need, which is a fact in the sense material. We may not find it so. Just like a child who has something which is really not meant to have. If some of you have children, a very small child, and you see your child with a matchbox, you have what you call matchbox? A box with matches. Generally speaking, a young child, 3 years old, you will try to take that box away from him, isn't it? The child won't be very happy with you. He wants the box. Or even worse, a piece of shiny glass. Not easy to take it away. Dangerous also. Not easy to take away our attachments to this world. process of devotional service is so nice. It's not just about taking them away, it's about learning how to use those attachments in relationship with Krishna. No difference. Everything that can be used in Krishna's service. Nibandha Krishna Sambandhay, the Varada Nishita. Everything should be used in Krishna's service, if it can be. We have to learn how to do that. And the other side is, he encourages us in the practical, the direct practice of devotion. He gives you the opportunity. A little bit of progress means you'll get more chance in the future for more opportunity for devotion. Sometimes people ask, what do you get out of chanting Hare Krishna? Prabhupada said, more chanting. Well, there's different ways of looking at that one, of course, there are. But in one sense, you do. You get more chance to chant. Well, yeah, but that doesn't answer my question. You're still chanting. Because they don't realize what that means. Eventually, you'll get a relish beyond every other type of pleasure you can imagine. Even in the beginning of devotional service, there is so much pleasure. You may have noticed, I don't know whether you've experienced that or not, but if we actually render service is not just anything. It means activity which is connected to pleasing Krishna. So we find out how to do that. We don't speculate. We inquire from those who know. That's why Krishna says you must approach a spiritual master, render service, because he teaches us what is service. Material, whatever, I'm serving, that doesn't make it devotional service. Don't just come here and do what you like. We find out what would be favorable, what would help. Maybe we're a little selfish in the beginning in one sense. What would help me to advance in Krishna consciousness? We may not be thinking, what will please Krishna? That's fine. And we find out what will help us. Okay, Prabhu, please, Mataji, please sweep the floor. Sweep the floor? I don't sweep floors. Okay then, wash the pots. I don't wash pots. Okay then, mow the lawn. I don't mow lawns. This means we're not in a very submissive mood, you could say. But trying to find a way to engage us. But the more we're submissive, the more Krishna reciprocates. So if you sweep the floor, clean the windows if you have any, then if you have any windows here, clean the glass, the picture frames or something. This is like into cleaning your heart. And you'll feel it. It's not like just cleaning the windows in your home or the windows in some office or something. It's a little different. This is directly related. Everything belongs to Krishna. You can see everything like that, but generally we don't. But in a temple you can see. This is everything in this temple room, this beautiful, beautiful temple room, is arranged for the pleasure of Krishna. You're also here for his pleasure. He's very happy to see you here, actually. Because you are his devotees, whether you realize it or not. And coming to the temple is a big thing. It's not just a start, maybe for some, but it's a big step in our progress in Krishna consciousness. What to speak of rendering service, chanting the holy names, hearing the Bhagavad Gita, reading these transcendental literatures. Whatever you can do, you do that. Whatever you do, whatever work you make, whatever it is, you try to make it as an offering unto me, Krishna says. You offer the fruits of your work, even if you're attached, offer them to Krishna. You will be the gainer, unlimitedly. In the material world, you get a relative return. When offered to Krishna, you get an eternal benefit, eternal return. Everything you offer increases more. Even if you die before completing the course, you start off where you left off in a previous lifetime. There is no loss. Krishna explains that in the fourth chapter. We'll move on to the third chapter. One minute. Any work begun on the material plane has to be completed, otherwise the whole attempt becomes a failure. You might like doing it, but it has no real benefit. But any work begun in Krishna consciousness has a permanent effect, even though you may not finish it in this life, that means. The performer of such work is therefore not at a loss, even if his work in Krishna consciousness is incomplete. So don't become disheartened, I can't do that. Oh, what happens if I don't follow? Arjuna asked this question. Big question Arjuna asked of Krishna. Next chapter or the one after? One after, fourth chapter, I think also. What happens to somebody who takes to this path but doesn't make it? You know, they give up. You take birth again in a way which is favorable. In a situation you can immediately take, and sometimes you see that, that when a person comes to Krishna consciousness, they take off really quickly. Really quick. Everything's just like natural. And then you come to a kind of a standstill. Well, you know what's happened? It's like you plateau off. You've reached a point where you may have left off in a previous life, usually what it is. Now you have to go further and make a little bit more effort to go further. You can't just keep cycling the same pace. You have to go a little bit more, an extra mile. The performer of such work, 1% done in Krishna consciousness, bears permanent results. You never lose it. So that the next beginning is from the point of 2%. Whereas in material activity, without 100% success, there's no profit. You have to start all over again. From scratch. You don't start off in the next life with $1 million in your bank account. Maybe you do. Yes, your karma. Your parents. Maybe billionaires, and they automatically open the bank account for you when you're a baby with $1 million in it. But no, that's not the case. You have to start from scratch and work through again. Ajamil, the famous person in ancient times who was considered to be a very sinful person indeed, Ajamil performed his duty in some percentage of Krishna consciousness. All he did was only good fortune in his life. Well, he had some when he was a child, then he became a real sinful person. He had one good fortune in his life. He named his child Narayan. Narayan. Most of you have got a name of God, or something related to that. Good fortune. They're always chanting the name of Krishna, Ram, something like Gopal. Whatever it is. Good fortune. And all those around you keep saying, where's Gopal? Have you seen Gopal? What's your name? What's that?
Shubhankar. Shubhankar.
Shubhankar. Shubhankar. Very auspicious. Very Christian. And your name?
Dhanraj.
Huh?
Dhanraj.
Dhanraj? Dhanraj. Very nice. You're collecting a lot of... You're the king of the collectors, are you? And what's your name?
Yogendra.
Yogeshwar?
Yogendra.
Yogendra. Oh. Big yogi, eh? Oh. You say you're from Delhi, Noida? Are you from Noida? All these names are not necessarily direct names of Krishna necessarily, they could be, but they're all related to Krishna. But if you have a name like, anyone got the name Krishna or Rama or Gopal in your name? Krishna, Rama, Gopal, what names do you have around here?
My name is
Damodar.
Damodar?
Damodar? Oh, nice. I still have the rope. That's tough. Usually in India they do. They tie the string around through that. Oh, you good. Have you seen Damodar anywhere? Where's Damodar? Oh, look, there he is on the wall. You're on the wall. Very auspicious. In the West, they also have names of Jesus. Most names are traced back to Jesus or one of his apostles. Most of them. Or they're related to something to do with God. Originally, now they're not. They call people all kinds of things now. And peanut, and now bozo, and all sorts of other people. Not so spiritually uplifting names. When you have a Krishna conscious name, it's good. So that was Ajamil, basically his good fortune. And when death came, and he named his son, he was a very old man, but he had a very young son. He didn't stop even in old age, he was in his 80s, he had a little baby practically. This is possible sometimes. And he was so attached when he was dying, he was crying, Ryan, Ryan, Ryan. His good fortune. Sounds easy, doesn't it? Well, there's many reasons behind that. It's not as easy as it sounds. But that was what happened. That released him from otherwise quite a lot of bad karma. Just by calling out once, whatever, how many times you must have called it, but calling out the name of Narayan. But the result was he enjoyed 100% by the grace of the Lord, because he was given a chance then to go further, which he did. Instead of being taken to the court of Yamaraj, he was released by the Vishnu Dutas. They gave him good instruction. He went to Hardwar, near Hardwar, and there he performed devotional service. Affected his life, and then he moved back to the spiritual realm. There is a nice verse in this connection in Srimad Bhagavatam, famous verse. Chakvasa dharmam charanam bhajam hare bhajana pakvota patetato yadi yatvakva vabhadram abodam ishakim uvata apto vachatam satarnataha. If someone gives up his occupation or duties and works in Krishna consciousness and then falls down on account of not completing his work, what loss is there on his part? And what can one gain if one performs his material activities perfectly? Or as the Christians say, it's in the Bible, what profiteth a man if he gain the whole world yet suffers the loss of his eternal soul? What is the gain? You're going to die and you lose it all. And then the next generation does the same thing. No one really gains anything. Maybe if there's nothing after life, so what? And those who understand, you know, there's an afterlife or a reincarnation, then, you know, there's no gain, or you're just taking birth again. Even if it is in heaven, so what? You're still in a material situation. And you have to come back again. It's like you go on holiday. I don't know if you go on holidays much in India. Maybe you have your May. May is holiday season?
Yes.
Where do people go for their holidays in India? Where do you go? Huh? Eight other villages. See what the village. Some people go to the mountains, I've seen, or some holiday resort. You work all year, you save your money, and you go for a holiday. Maybe that's what people in the West do. And then when the money runs out, you have to come back here. Come on, by the way. Right? Heaven's like that, yeah. When your good karma, your punya runs out, you have to come back and work again on the earthly plane. What do you want to stay in heaven for? It's still material. It's tempted. Most people don't know that. Oh, they have a misunderstanding, equate spirituality with heavenly elevation. Material activities and their results end with the body. But working Krishna consciousness carries a person again to Krishna consciousness, even after the loss of the body. At least one is sure to have a chance in the next life of being born again as a human being. And that's what Krishna's referring to in this verse. Save one from the greatest type of danger. The danger which is referred to here is the human form of life, which is meant for self-realization. It's meant for Brahma-jnana, it's meant for realization of Brahman. It's not meant for sense gratification. It's not meant for that. It's meant for jivasya, dukkha-jnana. And if we waste our human life without making that inquiry, making any progress towards the spiritual realm, we have no point in having a human birth. Human birth is not just meant to be an IT specialist or whatever you do. Like what people do in Mumbai, I don't know. What do the men do? What do the men do in Mumbai?
Engineers, doctors.
Engineers, doctors, whatever. You have to work, but that's not the goal of life. You have to work to maintain the body and the family, but that's not the goal of life. It's not the purpose. You don't need the human life for that. When you really analyze it, what's the point of that? No point. Animals also live. Maybe we say, well, they don't live very nicely, but they don't see it like that. They're quite content in their own way, as much as we are. So we work very hard, but what for? A human life is meant for a higher purpose. If we don't use it for that higher purpose, we won't have a human birth. Don't need it. Waste of time. Eating, sleeping, mating, and defending in human life are not the goal of human life. They have to go on. They're part necessities, but they're not the goal. To find out what a higher goal or purpose of human life is. So one who takes a little bit of devotion service is at least guaranteed that much. That you won't have to fall down into a hat. Because in animal birth, plant birth, fish birth, etc., there's next to no chance, there is a chance but it's very slim, of a spiritual practice. They have no intelligence to understand these things or to put them into practice in their lives. More or less, the lower species are completely conditioned by their karma, for the human life. They're not accumulating karma, they're reaping the result of their human karma. And maybe gradually they're coming up the evolutionary cycle, the soul transmigrating from one birth to the next, back to the human cycle of life. Human birth is a life of responsibility. This is a platform where karmas are accumulated. So even if you fail, as Prabhupada mentions here, this is mentioned later on in the third and fourth chapter, that either in the family of a great cultured Brahmin or in a very rich and aristocratic family, that will give one a further chance for elevation. That is the unique quality of work done in Krishna consciousness. So even in this lifetime, you may think, well, if I give everything to Krishna, if I work for Krishna, working for Krishna doesn't mean you have to give up your present situation or your family. It means that we learn how to work in relationship with Krishna for his pleasure. We learn how to offer our food to Krishna. We learn how to think in relationship with Krishna, etc., etc. Offer the fruits of our work in the service of Krishna. And you'll be surprised, you'll feel a lot happier doing that than we will be by utilizing those fruits for our own selfish intent. The more you give, the more you get. This life, human life, is really meant for that purpose, not for getting so much, for giving, for loving, giving, serving. You automatically get. You get much more than you do by trying to work separately from Krishna, because you feel so much more satisfied and more fearless. Old age and death can be unpleasant experiences, disease. A devotee may also, she could say, in one sense, experience these, but on another plane, the devotees are beyond this platform of experiencing the effects of the material energy. It's a little bit more elevated stage, but that's what will come. And that's nothing compared to the pleasure of connecting with Krishna. Okay, so we'll finish there at 8:30. Are there any questions? Yes, Prabhu, is there a microphone? Do with controversial issues, failure and success.
Failure and success, gain and loss.
Yes, are.
How do we relate with the spiritual world?
How does it relate with the spiritual world? The failure and loss in this world? In terms of, in general, or? In
no, it has to be specific to the Bhagavad Gita.
Okay. In relationship with our particular situation. Well, for a devotee or someone who's aspiring on the path of devotion or spiritual life, what is a gain, what is a loss? The material gains and losses are generally related. They're karmic. They're also related, you could say, to how we perceive what is a gain. What is a gain for one person is a loss for another. What is pleasing to one is not pleasing to another. It's a relative measure. It's not an absolute measure. So you can see later in the second chapter, particularly fifth chapter, many places where Krishna talks about this, not being disturbed in the face of success or failure, in the face of happiness and distress. This is looking at it from the material perspective. You will experience happiness and distress, whoever you are, even if we're trying to progress in spiritual life. So how does a devotee see that? Well, Prabhupada describes it in the sense, he says that when you feel happy, you should see that this is very Krishna's being kind to release me now of my good karma. And when I feel suffering, Krishna is now releasing me of my bad karma. Now this is looking at it from a material angle in one sense. Pure devotee may not even care to worry about that. But that's how you can see it. Don't get attached, thinking that Krishna consciousness means everything must be rosy. You know what that means? Everything must be, you know, just the way I like it. That is not necessarily a sign of spiritual success. Not necessarily. We see that many times great personalities who come into this world, they undergo great suffering. It appears from our perspective that they do. Jesus Christ, for instance, is a good example of that. But he teaches us how to rise beyond that and not just be trying to adjust things in a favorable way. So a devotee sees the happiness and distress in this world is a result of our karma. It's a result of our karma, but there's another factor working. That's Krishna's hand. He knows what's best for us. Just like a parent should know what's best for his child, Krishna knows what's best for us. So he puts us sometimes in a position which appears to be a failure, or maybe a success from the material perspective. Why? Because we either need to come, let's say, let go of this idea of I want to adjust this world in a way which is favorable to what I think is favorable. Or he's trying to, because we're more a little bit more, say, let's say, attached to Krishna, give us the opportunity to show how riches can be used in his service. So the devotee sees in every situation he tries to show how even in failure you can become Christian, could be Krishna conscious. Because materially everyone's going through this duality. This life, next life, over and over again. The devotee shows how to be Krishna conscious in every situation. Even if you're in a distressful situation, even if you're on your deathbed, even if you're being insulted, even if everything around you is falling to pieces. We don't work for that to happen, but sometimes it happens. The devotee's speech shows how you can still be focused in Krishna consciousness in all conditions. Otherwise, if it's only when you're thinking things are good from the material perspective, it doesn't work like that in the material. And it will make people think that spiritual life is some kind of punya, material punya. And they measure it like that. I know when I was in Malaysia for many years, one group of Christians, they were preaching like that. That the proof of genuine religion is how much money you've got. And you Hindus, they were saying, are all poor. We Christians are all rich. They were preaching like this, which wasn't really true, but they were preaching like that. And for many Hindus, they thought that was right because they were poor. And they changed their religion. But this type of understanding is not spiritual understanding, it's the wrong understanding. And so, anyway, you can't, buy good karma. You have to get your karma according to how you follow the dharma, or the directions of this Veda, the guidelines for living in this world. In the human life, Vedas of the humans. So it's really learning how to be Krishna consciousness in all situations, whatever the duality may be, happy or distressed, success or failure. The devotee shows how to be Krishna conscious. It's not just about tolerating it and being undisturbed. That's one stage of dhira. That's a very preliminary stage. The real stage is showing and the devotee is in a distressed condition. He thanks the Lord. Actually, I feel I really deserve to suffer a lot more. But you are very merciful, my Lord. And the devotee doesn't ask for any relief. They just glorify the Lord. This is the beginning, you could say, of our entry into the spiritual kingdom. Such a person becomes eligible candidate to enter the spiritual world. We don't see it in the way that God is my order supplier. Save me, my Lord. The beginning stage, that's fine, but that's not the spiritual perspective. We don't see God as our order supplier. Oh, my Lord, give me this day my daily bread and so on. We don't see him as a baker or some kind of shopkeeper providing all our daily needs. Not God's business. He wants a loving relationship with us. He doesn't want a business relationship. I worship you if you give me my bread. I worship you if you give me heaven. Sometimes that business mentality is there. You want to be free of that. Whatever you give me, my Lord, thank you very much. I take shelter of you. I love you. A little while elevated. objective, there's no successor. From the spiritual platform, there's no such thing as success or failure, happiness, distress, as we know it. These are all relative karmic experiences which we go through. These arise above it. A karma rise above this material platform. A devotee is supposed to show that also, as well as practically practice the path which that automatically takes place. Anything else? I don't know if that's any good for you now. Yes, Prabhu.
Thank you, Maharaj. This verse speaks about how even little endeavor on this path can protect us from the greatest danger. So this can create a kind of complacency in the practitioner that even if I am a little bit, that's okay. Why should I be so much concerned? On the other hand, there can be a stress in the practice that I want to complete my process in this very lifetime. I want to go back to God in very, very lifetime. So that can create a kind of stress that I want to practice so well that
a stress.
This is complicated.
You say stress.
Yes.
Stress.
So how should we, like another place Krishna said that this path is susukam kartum avayam.
Quite simple, isn't it? He could sometimes, even like with the Jamil, he just chanted Hare Krishna and Narayan. And he was deliberate. He didn't go back to Godhead, of course. He did eventually, but not just by chanting Narayan once. So how did you, do you live in the ashram? Is he a lazy guy or what? Did he just do that? Huh? Hard worker. No wonder he was stressed out. We're working him too hard. He's stressed. No? Huh?
Most ecstatic.
You're the most ecstatic. You're not stressed. Why do you say it creates stress? Does it? It may do if you have this wrong. One of the reasons is you know, there's this thing that goes along. It's not just working hard in devotional service and thinking that's going to end up with the result of going back to Godhead or whatever you want to call it, perfecting your life in devotion. There's nothing wrong. Yes, work hard. But there has to be some understanding or the consciousness in which we work. Tasmat Sarvashim Hidupa. Mamanusha Yujicha. I have to tell my daughter. Anyway, Krishna says, boy, work. Be conscious of me also. Not just about working. The idea is to be conscious of Krishna as well. Working hard, offering the fruits to Krishna, or working under direction. But what is your purpose? What is your attitude? What is your consciousness when you work? It's also important. And depending upon Krishna. I remember one time, I guess it's related, I'll give an example anyway. It was 1975. We were in England. We were going out in around the country in different vehicles, trying to raise money, to be honest, because the temple was in so much debt in London. We were about to be closed down. The law cases, so many things were being filed against us. We had to collect money, so we were going out selling various things, candles, records, whatever we could to make money for the temple. We were full-time brahmacharis. And it was almost like I was in a party, a responsible position, but for this purpose I was in a party, the leader of our party was a German devotee. I don't know if he was a part of the Third Reich, but he was like a, my goodness, he was, I don't know what you call him, a panzer of the time, he was like a real general. 6:30 in the morning, we hit the street. 6:30, rain, wind, or snow. We're on the street at 6:30 trying to sell things. We come back at 6:30 at night, 7 o'clock. And you have no, then there's all day, 12 hours a day, just trying to collect money on the street by selling things. Well, I never joined the Hare Krishna movement to do this. I mean, okay, surrender. felt like packing my bags and going to somewhere else. Anywhere. It was both my nation, materially speaking. And I came to the point where I thought, well, Krishna is the supreme personality. I came here with that, in some faith at least. And I want to serve him. Some faith with him. So my Lord, you know everything. If this is what you want me to do, if this is really what you want me to do, so be it. But you'll have to help me because I can't do it. So I prayed. I don't pray very often, but I prayed. I'm a bit selfish, but I was trying to make it a bit Krishna conscious. And I prayed, please, if this is what you want me to do, please give me the strength to do it. Can't do it otherwise. I'm just not strong enough. Not enough. And believe me, it was quite an experience. It's a reality which gave me a bit of increased faith. The very next day I was doing exactly the same thing, but it was like I was no longer the doer. If you think you're the doer, then you're going to get stress. But I'm doing so much service, more than anyone else. Not getting respected, or why am I doing this? I'm not getting paid. I could be doing something else. You know, kinds of mindsets. But I gave that up. Krishna removed that from my relationship with this activity. I was feeling very joyful doing what the day before was a real stress. And I didn't worry. I said, no, Krishna, you want me to do this forever? I'm willing to do it forever. It just pleases you. It was quite a turnaround just by doing nothing really, just by trying to, you know, place yourself in Krishna's hands. And it was no longer a cause of stress. And that week we went back to the temple and the GBC came up to me. GBC, if you don't know what it means that managing authority in temple or in that country like that. So he came up to me and said, I'm really sorry, Jananda Prabhu. I know this is not really very pleasing to you, but we really need you to stay back in the temple now and not do that service anymore. I laughed. I didn't say a word, but I laughed inside like anything. Krishna knows everything. When you're ready, see, he changes things like that. Put me into what I want. I never asked, but he put me in the service I wanted to do. Maybe that was worse. Maybe I should have stayed on the street. That's what he asked me to do, so I did it. I just saw Krishna's hand working. You see Krishna's hand working and there's no more stress. If you think you see yourself in the center or someone else in the center, then you know, you're going to get this likelihood of being, you know, depressed or stressed. Depressed and distressed are everyone's the same. Or, you know, you get proud or whatever it may be, and some unfavorable kind of perspective. You try to put Krishna in the center, to try to see how everything's revolving, acting under his direction, place yourself in that position. That becomes, I remember another young devotee in Malaysia, and he was really in a difficult situation for various reasons. And he had good reason to think so, but he just accepted and surrendered to the authority. And the next time I saw him, how's he going? So fantastic. Still doing the same thing. So I just changed my perspective and everything else changed. It's not what you do so much, it's your attitude and how you work. But not the degree that we're seeing ourselves in the center rather than Krishna. Put Krishna's center is the most. If there is any stress, it's only stress to bring pleasure to Krishna. That kind of stress is blissful. Very blissful. All right, we'll finish there.